Hey, Crosspoint, we are loving this series called Frequency of Joy, and it's given us an opportunity to get to hear from some really great pastors and teachers and some of the best we know. And it's been full-on summer now. I mean, the heat is going. You remember like back in the day when you'd have to turn on the AC? If you had AC. If you didn't have AC, you rolled down the windows. But it was back in those days before Spotify, before Apple Music, when all we had was radio. And you were at the mercy of wherever you were on the planet and whatever you could dial in. Those old school knobs. And maybe you kind of work the knobs until you find something good to come in. Well, today we're talking in how to dial in to the presence of God and how to have more joy in our life. And today in the series, we get a chance to hear from Pastor Derwin Gray. Now, before he was a pastor, he played football in the NFL. I believe he played with the Carolina Panthers and with the Colts. And so, both of us, like, we've got a lot in common. I mean, we both play professional ball and we're both pastors now today. We're about the same size. We bench press about the same. We got a lot in common. But today you get a chance to hear from Pastor Derwin. And he's taking on something that we all struggle with at time, we wrestle with. We're all trying to tackle. You see what I did there, football. But anyway, that we all trying to tackle is that, is like, how do we have joy when we're going through hard times? Like when we're going through things difficult, similar like the year that many of us just had. And you know, our team went out to Transformation Church where Pastor Derwin leads to capture this message because we believe that it's one that we needed to hear, one that you need to hear right now, where you're at, whatever you're going through in life. And my prayer for you today is that you'd be in a position to receive God's comfort, to receive His courage, to receive His truth, and to take hold of the promises that He has for you, and to find joy in exactly what you're walking through right now.
Hey, what's happening, Crosspoint Church? This is Pastor Derwin Gray, and on behalf of your sister church in the Charlotte area, Transformation Church, it is always an honor, it is always a privilege to proclaim the good news of King Jesus to you. I'm so thankful for your pastor. I'm thankful for our relationship. I'm thankful for the way that he has encouraged me. And so it's pretty cool for us to be able to share this moment. And so I'm gonna pray for us and we're gonna dive right in. So let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, the name that is above all names, the one who is the joy of the Lord, the one who does make us happy in a way that transcends feelings and emotions, but roots us in a deep purpose. And you do this so that we could experience the Father's presence, the Father's love. Lord, we have been created for you and by you to know you and to experience the depths of intimacy with you. Into me you see, that when we see your face of grace, we can never, ever be the same. And so I pray, whether we've walked with you for many years, or whether we are confused, whether we are backslidden, whether we are doubting, whether we're brand new in our faith, or whether we want to know if God really loves us, would you meet us in such a way that we know that you do? Transform us, Lord Jesus, in your name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. So I grew up in San Antonio, Texas. I grew up on the west side, grew up poor, not poor because we couldn't afford the O and the R. So growing up in the 70s, one of the things that we would do to entertain ourselves, because we didn't have smartphones, we didn't have TikTok, we didn't have all that stuff. So my grandmother would be like, listen, go outside and play, and when the sun goes down, then you come home. And so one of the things we did growing up was we would chase our shadows. Now, I know in our technological age, we go, oh, that isn't fun. No, chasing your shadow is fun, particularly when you are young, is you get excited because you actually think you're gonna catch your shadow. And the closer you get, the further away it moves. Well, chasing our shadow is like chasing happiness. What if the happiness were running ourselves into physical, mental, and emotional exhaustion for is inferior to the happiness we've been created to experience? What if created things were never meant to make us happy in the way we desire to experience happiness? Now, I know for many of us, coming out of a pandemic, coming out of racial riots, coming out of political chaos, for goodness sakes, we have like buildings collapsing in the United States of America. Like things are just not what we thought they were going to be. Or maybe you're 10 years into a marriage and you're going, this is not what I signed up for. Maybe you're a teenager and you're trying to discover who you are in this world. And we're going, can I really be happy? And the answer is yes. But let me ask you another question. What if the happiness and joy we were created for is beyond feelings and good things always happening to us? What if God has a happiness that is deeper and more beautiful than simply feeling good or good things happening? What if there is a happiness that we've been created for that can never, ever be found in created things, but only in the uncreated Creator Himself revealed in the person of Jesus? So I'm a lot like you, right? We are Americans, and there's this thing called the American dream. The American dream says that you can be successful, but here's the problem about being successful. What you do on the outside does not fix what's happening on the inside, and we almost get addicted to events happening, that if an event happens, I feel good, and everything else is boring. And so we're waiting for events. It's like we've become addicted to events. Addicted to success. So growing up, my mom and dad both struggled with various issues, love them. I'm thankful for my grandparents that took me in, took care of me, came from an environment that was very dysfunctional, very chaotic, lots of trauma, lots of pain, but you normalize those types of things, which we should never normalize those types of things. But at age 13, I said to myself, I'm going to escape my environment, and the way that I'm going to do it is through football. In the state of Texas, we do barbecue real good and we do football really good. So growing up in that environment, football for me was more than a game. Football was a means of worship. I wouldn't have said that, but worship is this: you find your affirmation, you find your identity, you find your purpose. Football said this: if you play good, you can succeed. Your identity as a football player made you stand out. Purpose was, I woke up every morning with a desire to get better at my craft, to go to school, to get a scholarship, to escape. And so I got a football scholarship to Brigham Young University. So here I go from San Antonio, Texas, all the way to Utah, freshman year, second semester, meet my wife. We've been together ever since, have an incredible college football career, left there as one of the greatest defensive backs to ever play there. So everything is going good. Like, I'm pursuing the happiness, right? The American dream. And then I get drafted to the NFL. First year's tough, second year's better. Third year, I'm at my pinnacle. I'm a team captain. We're crushing it. I'm doing my thing. I'm balling. Got some money. Able to send money home to my family. But at the end of that season, something happened. And this is it. I said, there's got to be more than this. Because the happiness that I want and the happiness that you want, it was like fleeting feelings. It was like fleeting moments. And eventually, through a teammate named Steve Grant, his nickname was the Naked Preacher, he would preach after practice with a white towel wrapped around his waist and his Bible, asking teammates, do you know Jesus? And eventually, he asked me that question, and it took 5 years. But on August 2nd, 1997, in a small dorm room in Anderson, Indiana, is when I met Jesus, when I found out that he's a forgiver, when I found out that he is a lover, when I found out that he is merciful, when I found out that he was kind, but when I found out he was inviting me into a deeper and more beautiful type of happiness. But check this out. In order for you and I to experience the happiness or joy we were created for, the way up is down. Let me say it again. The way up is down. And this is what I mean by this. In the greatest sermon ever preached by the greatest preacher to ever preach, King Jesus invites us into the happiness we were created for. So Jesus is getting ready to preach the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, verses chapter 7. But he starts the Sermon on the Mount with what is commonly called the Beatitudes. The scripture reads this way in Matthew 5, 1 through 12. When he sat down, the crowds were around him at the mountain. Verse 2, then he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the humble, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons and daughters of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. You are blessed when they insult you and persecute you and falsely say every kind of evil against you because of me. Be glad and rejoice, because your reward is great in heaven. For this is how they persecuted prophets who were before you." So let's pause here. Jesus opens up this incredible sermon with an invitation to true happiness. But you're going, "Pastor, what are you talking about?" So the Greek word blessed is the word makros, and it literally means happy, a state of happiness. And Jesus unfolds these eight characteristics of the Beatitudes, and he's saying, "Let me turn you into this type of person." Now understand this, for those of you who are exploring Jesus and those of you who come from a performance-based living, meaning this, that my life is the sum total of what I do, understand this, God doesn't need your effort. God doesn't need your performance. Jesus has done it all. When Jesus went to the cross, he not only forgave our sins, but for 33 years, he lived the life that you and I could not live. Jesus embodied the Beatitudes. Jesus is saying, this is what it looks like to be a human being in the kingdom of God, and you don't have to look at it. You can actually experience it. You can allow me to transform you into this type of person, a happy person that is no longer contingent upon situations our circumstances. True happiness is not about good things perpetually happening to us. It's about Jesus. Here it is. It's about Jesus making us good for the world. The reason why we are not happy is we are looking for created things to make us happy. We are looking for our own agenda to make us happy. We are looking for other people to make us happy. The joy of the Lord is King Jesus himself. But here's the deal, Cross Point Church, the way up is down. We're going to look at one beatitude, the first one. Matthew 5:3 says this, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs." So write this down. Number one, we go up by admitting we're down. We go up by admitting we are down. I've often heard it said this, you can't be full of Jesus when you are full of yourself. We can't be full of Jesus when we are full of ourselves, and the way up is down. Happiness is found in admitting how much we need him. And that's why the first beatitude starts with, "Blessed or happy are the poor, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." What does that mean? It means this, is that Jesus did not pursue you. Jesus did not come to earth because we just had a little problem and we could fix ourselves. No, Jesus came for people like me and you who are spiritually bankrupt. That when we go to the accounting office of God, not only does it say zero deficit in our account, it says infinite deficit in our account. We have to understand that we are more messed up than we realize, but we are more loved than we realize. That grace and the kingdom of God is only for those who say, "God, I can't, but I know that you can. I often have heard a story, and it kind of goes like this. There was a man who had passed away, and he's standing at the pearly gates, and St. Peter is there, and he's talking to St. Peter, and Peter is interviewing people. And Peter gets this man and he says, "Sir, why should you enter into the kingdom of God? What have you done?" And so the man begins to explain, he did this, he did that, he was in the Boy Scouts, he was in this, and he did all these things. And he said, "Well, can I get in?" And St. Peter says, "No, you can't get in." And the man says, "Well, what can I do? I can't do nothing. Lord, have mercy." And Peter goes, "Now you can come in. Because God's kingdom is only for those who go, Lord, have mercy." You see, when you and I compare ourselves to other people, inevitably, we're gonna be better than somebody, we're gonna be worse than somebody. But the Bible's very clear, for we have all sinned and fall short of God's glory. Let me pause here. The word sin doesn't just mean to make a boo-boo. Sin means this, that I am renouncing my right to rule and to reign with Jesus. It is cosmic treason. And in the midst of that, God is gracious and says, "You deserve to be away from me, but my love draws me towards you. But you can't receive my love until you recognize that you are poor in spirit." One of the things that I say often at Transformation Church is this: the only thing good in me is Jesus. Not my preaching, not my teaching, not my husbanding, not being a pet, nothing but nothing. Empty hands I bring, simply to the cross I cling. That the kingdom of God is reserved for those who understand that ego, edging God out, will not allow you into his kingdom. We need a new kind of ego, exalting God only. The cross is for the poor in spirit. The cross is for those who go, "God, I need you." You see, the gift of God's salvation and entrance into his kingdom is also entrance into a happiness that is beyond things that happen, that is beyond situations, that is beyond circumstances. It's a happiness that's rooted in the purpose of God. And what happens to us? We begin to become humble. That's why Jesus talks about, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted," and then, "Blessed are the humble, for they will inherit the earth." One of the ways that we know that we recognize that we're poor in spirit is we recognize our great need for Jesus. This humility, this poor in spirit, does not mean that we are self-loathing. It does not mean that we are self-hating. It means this: all that Jesus is, I am, because he is the great I am. A beautiful miracle takes place when we recognize that Jesus took our place on a cross. Think about this. He bled and died, not just to forgive your sins, but to create in you a happiness that produces holiness. What is holiness, family? Holiness means that we begin to take upon the image of Christ, the character of Christ. And Jesus was the most humble, beautiful person to ever live. Jesus was the happiest person to ever live, because happiness is not an emotion. Happiness is faithfulness to the God who has called you and to the God who loves you. You see, the way up is down. You see, for Jesus, he was strung up on a cross and went down. And because he rose again, you too can rise again. That we don't have to be dependent upon situation or circumstance. Now, I'm like you. I mean, I love a good situation. I love a good circumstance. But the reality is, life is not always that way. So what do? We look for created things to make us happy. So we end up worshiping them and using God. And God is saying, no, worship me and use created things. You see, the way up is actually down. Happy are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. So we go up by recognizing that we live in and from the life of Christ, that our happiness is a person, and his name is Jesus. And it almost makes us circumstance proof, that it's not always vacillating emotions, but a commitment. Listen to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. It says this: "And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you previously walked according to the ways of this world, according to the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit now working in the disobedient. We too all lived among them in our fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and thoughts, and we were by nature children under wrath as the others were also." Verse 4, pause. Let me pause here. It says, "But God." Whenever you see "but" in a Bible, something big is about to happen. And never forget, God loves big buts and he cannot lie. Satan may try to get you to deny, but when you see "but" in the Bible, something big is about to happen. "But God, who is rich in mercy." Notice this: a pandemic does not affect God's merciness. A bad economy does not affect God's mercy. God's mercy is infinite. It never runs out. It cannot be qualified, but it can change your life. He is merciful. Why? Because of his great love that he loved, that he had for us. What did he do? He made us alive with Christ, even though we were dead in our trespasses. You see, we go up by living in and from the life of Christ. If you don't hear one thing in this message, understand this: Jesus does not need you to be a co-pilot. Jesus does not need your help. Jesus does not need you to quote unquote live for him. He rose from the dead. We need his help. We need his life. And it is a supernatural, beautiful mystery that God himself through faith lives in us. And so our happiness becomes a part of walking with him. Our happiness becomes a part of worshiping him, that all of life becomes worship. Here's one of the ways that we know that we're poor in spirit is we become grateful for even the air that we breathe. We become grateful for the sun that shines. We become grateful and hopeful for people. And we recognize that God is attracted to weakness. For the Bible says that in our weaknesses, Christ is made strong in us. Listen, the way up is going down. We go down on our knees to look up, and Christ lifts us up and says, "I want to live in you and I want to live through you." So I got a question for you. What if the happiness we're driving ourselves into mental and physical and emotional exhaustion is not what we were created for? What if the happiness we were created for is a happiness that says this: "Jesus, I have tried it my way, but now I want to live in you and I want to live from you. Jesus, I want a happiness that is beyond situations and circumstances. I want a happiness that leads to holiness so that I can be good for the world and join you in repairing this world." That you only use the poor in spirit, because the poor in spirit are those who are filled with the power of Jesus. Cross Point Church, happy are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Will you pray with me? Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, today I choose happiness, because through the Holy Spirit's power, I choose Jesus. Happiness is not a place. Happiness is a person. Happiness is not a situation. Happiness is the cross. Happiness is not happenings, but the greatest happening of all, Jesus raising from the dead. And through faith in him, what I'm saying is, God, you and you alone are my joy. You and you alone are my purpose. And I trust you. I want to be poor in spirit so I can be rich in you. Perhaps there's some of you listening saying, preacher, I want to come to know Jesus. I've never trusted him as my Savior and King. I've never given him my life. And today I want to do that. Today is your day. Jesus is calling you. Today's the day to have a new start, a fresh start, a new life. If that's you, in the silence of your heart, say this: King Jesus, today I believe that I was spiritually dead, but through your death on the cross and your resurrection, I can be made alive with you. And by faith, I believe that on that cross you died and 3 days later you rose again. And today I give you my allegiance and I choose to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, Cross Point Church.